Hi, I'm Johnny from Modern Green Thumb, and today I've come indoors to do more of a technical video. I'm going in depth on the Earth Battery Greenhouse, a system that helps regulate the temperatures inside your greenhouse by using the natural heat of the ground. This method can keep your greenhouse from freezing in cold seasons, even in very cold climates. Stick around as we discuss what they are, how they work, their design considerations, pros and cons, and practical tips for maximizing your greenhouse. So what exactly is an Earth Battery Greenhouse and why is it so special? The idea is pretty simple but very powerful. Similar to a rechargeable electric battery that stores energy to be used later, the Earth itself can be used as a rechargeable source or sink of energy. You're using the Earth itself to help regulate the temperatures inside the greenhouse, which means you can keep growing plants even in cold winters without needing expensive heaters. Well, how does this work? Underneath the greenhouse, there's a network of pipes buried in the soil. These pipes allow air to circulate underground where the temperature is much more stable. In the winter, the air in the pipes picks up heat from the relatively warmer ground before returning it to the greenhouse, raising the temperature of the greenhouse. And in the summer, the reverse happens. The air cools down as it moves through the relatively cooler earth, helping to keep the greenhouse cooler. I love this concept. Instead of relying on traditional heating or cooling systems, you're using the thermal mass of the earth to help moderate the temperatures of the greenhouse. Depending on how you design it, there can be a small or large initial investment, but once it's set up, it costs virtually nothing to run. It's just a small fan to keep the air moving. How much tube length is needed to be placed underneath the greenhouse? Getting the calculations right is important to make sure that the system works most efficiently in transferring heat. Specifically, we need to figure out how much pipe to bury underground to properly heat and cool the greenhouse, and what kind of airflow is needed to keep the temperature stable inside the greenhouse. The first key calculation is the length of the tubing required. The rule of thumb here is that the length of the tubing should be at least equal to the cubic volume of your greenhouse divided by 10. My greenhouse is about 10 feet wide by 20 feet long and 9 feet high at the peak. So to calculate the volume, I broke it down into simple shapes, a rectangle for the walls and a triangle for the roof. After running the numbers, I found that the total volume of my greenhouse is about 1,500 cubic feet. To make sure that the earth battery system could handle that volume, I need at least 150 feet of linear tubing underneath the ground. To be safe, I decided to round up to 200 feet of tubing because the tubes come in lengths of 100 usually when you buy them from the store. That would make things easy for me. Now that we've covered the calculations for determining the minimum tube length and fan capacity, let's explore how we can place these pipes underneath the greenhouse. There are several ways to arrange these pipes, and each pattern that we'll talk about may affect the efficiency of your system. The simplest layout is a single layer of pipes running from one end of the greenhouse to the other end of the greenhouse. Typically, you would bury them about 18 inches deep so that there's still another foot of soil above your pipes. The intake and the exhaust would be on opposite sides of the greenhouse. And while this does work, it doesn't maximize the heat transfer and may not provide enough tube length buried underneath the ground for every situation. A step up from a single layer would be a U-shape. This is where the pipes run down and back, forming a U, and the intake and the exhaust are on the same side of the greenhouse. This allows for more pipe to be placed underneath the ground, but still may not provide enough pipe to be underground, depending on your situation. In my project, I used an S pattern. In the S pattern, the pipes zigzag back and forth across the greenhouse in an S pattern, with the lowest layer being about 4 to 5 feet deep. The intake and the exhaust in this pattern would be on opposite sides of the greenhouse. This pattern increases the pipe length in a given area, improving heat exchange. This provides a great balance between the cost of digging deep enough and allowing plenty of tube length to be placed underneath the ground. The last type of pattern I will talk about is the W pattern. This is similar to the S pattern, but has one additional turn. In this case, the intake and the exhaust of the system would end up on the same side of the greenhouse. This can be nice if you have a limited amount of space that you can excavate. However, it can increase the cost as you have to dig down much deeper. In this case, you would probably have to go beyond 5 feet. Remember, the deeper you place your pipes, the more stable the ground temperature. The goal is to maximize the contact between the air in the pipes and the soil surrounding for a more efficient heat transfer. Whichever pattern you choose, the key is to balance maximizing pipe length with any other practical considerations you have, like cost. Some greenhouses, depending on their weight or size, may require a concrete foundation. Whether you choose a concrete foundation or not, there is one key element that you should not skip. That is insulation. You'll want to place insulation between the soil underneath the greenhouse and the soil outside the greenhouse's footprint. This insulation helps create a thermal break, keeping heat underneath your greenhouse. In my project, we do have a concrete foundation below the greenhouse. We used 4 feet by 8 feet rigid foam insulation boards that are 2 inches thick. We lined the inside of the concrete walls with the insulation boards. And if you don't have concrete walls, you can still hold the insulation in place while you backfill the excavation area. This insulation serves a vital purpose. It helps to contain the heat stored in the soil under your greenhouse, preventing it from dissipating to the surrounding earth. Remember, the goal of an earth battery greenhouse is to use the stable temperatures of the earth to help moderate your greenhouse temperatures. By insulating the perimeter, you can create a more efficient system that can better maintain those ideal growing conditions you're aiming for. So whether you're using a concrete foundation or not, do not skip on this step. It is a relatively small investment and can significantly boost the performance of your earth battery system. As we wrap up this episode on earth battery greenhouses, I hope you've gained valuable insights into how this innovative system can help you grow plants year-round, even in very harsh climates. We've explored the theory behind earth batteries, discussed essential design considerations, and examined practical tips for setting up your own system. This type of system does require some upfront costs. Remember, the key to a successful earth battery greenhouse lies in careful planning, proper calculations, and thoughtful design. By utilizing the natural heat of the ground, you can create a sustainable growing environment that requires minimal energy input. If you found this video helpful, please consider sharing it with fellow gardening enthusiasts or anyone interested in gardening or greenhouse growing. I'd love to hear your thoughts and questions and comments below. What aspects of the earth battery greenhouse are you most excited about? What are some questions you still have about the system? I can follow up in future videos or respond in the comments below. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel for more in-depth videos on greenhouse gardening. In the next episode, I'll take you through my project plan and how I implemented these design principles in the construction of my earth battery greenhouse. Thanks for watching, and until next time, happy growing.